really got the rough end of the stick, didn't I? I had to go last. I had to go after James and Breen, and then I almost was standing up and saying to Paul, I come with you. So I really didn't get the rough end of the stick. The last time I saw my father, and I was thinking about this today, and I said to myself, will I go with this, won't I? And I decided to go with it because it's an important part of why Carl and I are doing what we're doing through Soar. The last time I saw my father was a month before he passed away, and we had queued in the hospital in Galway for 6 hours. He was dying of cancer, asbestosis, and I remember very, very clearly spending the day with him, and he was very, very poorly. I'd flown back from university in Canada to see him, and doctor said, he won't last a week, you better come back, and I came back. I remember so clearly sitting with him, and towards the end of the day, I thought I may not see him again. So I decided that I was going to tell him I loved him. And I remember saying to myself, how will I say this? And the way I actually said it was, I thanked him for everything he'd done for me throughout my life. And I remember the difficulty it took to even say those words. And what he came back with was, I couldn't have got through today without you. Now, a month later, my sister rang me. I was about to sit a university exam in Canada. I was thinking today, I was counting, I've had around 19 years education. And I was laughing about it because I was about to go in and sit an exam when I was asked to come home. Now, the reason I tell you that story is because why was it so difficult for me to say to my father that I loved him? Why is it that some of the things are so important for us to say, the real things, we find so incredibly difficult? And the conclusion I came to when I asked myself that question preparing for tonight was that we've spent so long, probably since the Industrial Revolution, educating the mind. But somewhere along the line, we forgot about the heart. We forgot to educate that piece of ourselves, that quiet self that is so, so important. Also, when you think about it, we're the most educated people of all time in this country. As I said, 19 years of education, a whole load of Canadian university debt. We're the most educated people of all time, and yet our people are the most medicated of all time. Much of our adult population is medicated, depression, so many things that we're pushing away. Why is it that our young people, the suicide rate is so incredibly high? Why is it that our depression rate in young people, our alcohol dependency in young people, our self-harm in young people is so high? And this for the most educated people of all time? Somewhere along the line, we forgot to educate our hearts. And that's why I'm so encouraged to hear what you had to say there, Paul. So encouraged. 50 years ago, you'd probably be in jail for what you said tonight. The important thing that I've learned from preparing for tonight is that we are at an incredibly, incredibly special time in our country's history. We're at a real threshold. It's one where we can create a society where it's absolutely acceptable to be yourself, whatever that is. James is a perfect example of it. Can you imagine if James hadn't followed his heart? Can you imagine how many young people would go without what he is in the process of creating to give them self-expression? The Dalai Lama said something which I still laugh when I heard it. A friend of mine texted me this morning. And he said, in the Western world, we spent 2,000 years studying outer space. And by that he meant material wealth and the accumulation of knowledge about the world outside us. Yet in the East, they've spent 2,000 years studying inner space. When somewhere along the line, guys, we stopped recognizing the importance of inner space. In here. Carl and I set up SOAR because we were very concerned about young people. We had watched the rates of suicide rise and we'd watched the levels of disease in our young people. The World Health Organization says that mental ill health has reached epidemic proportions in the West. We decided that we were going to do something. We both threw everything we had into it, financial and otherwise, and we flew to Australia, all because a man called Jim Steins that left this city at 17 or 18 years of age, went there and impacted 500,000 teenagers, and we've met them. Not all of them, obviously, but we've met many of them, and their confidence at 17 and 18 years of age just blew us away. We came back and we set up SOAR Sean and all the guys at Social Entrepreneurs believed in us. They give us an award, and we've been in the schools for a year now. I'm going to share two stories with you of two of the kids that we've worked with, just to give you an insight into what we do. We run programs where we develop self-confidence and self-esteem, but really we don't develop it. They do. Young people do, 10 to 18 year olds. We work with six classes and transition years. What we do is we create spaces where young people can begin the process of opening up to understand who are they? What do they want to do with their life? What are their dreams for themselves? And then equip them with the self-confidence and self-esteem that they need to go and do that. A girl we met in Donegal, you're probably aware, Donegal has had a lot of suicide amongst young people, two in one family. We went up there and we ran a workshop for a week with different schools. One girl came up to me afterwards. She was kind of playing with her jumper. You know how sometimes when we're nervous, kind of like I am now, you play with your a piece of your kind of your body, take the focus off your words. This girl came up to me and she said, you know, I always wanted to be a journalist, but I never really had the confidence. That was fine. She rang me a week later and she said, I just entered a competition run by the GEA for Young Journalist of the Year Award. I forgot about her. And last Thursday she rang to say she'd won it. Miriam Fitzsimons is her name. Go onto the front page of the GA website and you'll see her article. Second was a workshop we ran down in a school in Wexford for boys, transition year. This guy at the back, we were talking about difficult times that we've went through that can shape us, that can define us as people. This big strapping guy, you could see he was a real athlete in the class, stood up at the back and he said, I lost my dad when I was 11. And we've never really gotten over as a family. We said to him, was it difficult for your moment for everyone? He said, really difficult, because I had to become the dad before I was ready. There was silence in class. No smiling, no laughing, just absolute respectful silence. Afterwards, his teacher came up to us and he said, what happened there? And we said, how do you mean? He said, his father died by suicide when he was 11 and he's never spoken about it. When we permit people the permission to open up and to speak about what is really going on in their lives, to have authentic conversations, everything changes. Now, where we are in our country's history at the moment, we need that more than ever. We need people like you, Paul Rowe. We need people like you, James, and you, Green. But this isn't an educational issue. This is our issue. Because we're all each other's teachers. And we all have a role to play in this. All of us. Because the future that we are creating, there's a brand new construction industry in Ireland. I don't know if you hear about this. It's a construction industry that's based on constructing a new society based on love. And what Carol and I are doing and trying our best, and we don't have all the answers, is we're in the process of giving young people, 10 to 18 year olds, the space where they can begin by loving themselves. And then they go on, they do amazing things with their lives, just like Mary, just like that young man in Wexford. So, to bring this full circle, the good news is it's already begun. Because you're all here. We all have a part to play. We are on the threshold of something special as a country. We are. And we're a brilliant people. We've been through very, very difficult times, undoubtedly. But what we must do is we must merge within our education system the head and the heart, the inner space and the outer space. And as we do that, what we will begin to see is much more balanced young people. Much more balanced adults, and a much, much healthier country. Thanks very much.